So he's a rampant individualist.
Well, he may be, but the argument of Jack and others is that we identify collectively with the little person to overcome this. Now, it may be that at the end all things are resolved and society goes back to the way it was, but you raised the matter that many of these stories are about power and about power relationships, and in fact Jack's most recent book is called The Sorcerer's Apprentice, which he argues is a classic, if you like, trans-historical, transnational investigation of the master-slave relationship. So within folk literature, as indeed Maxim Gorky, no less, recognised, there are these subversive elements, and we've included one or two in Reading and Rebellion, in one case the Till Eulenspiegel stories, which were in their own way very subversive about the powers that be at the time in Germany, sort of circa 1500.
But can you take us forward, if you could, from where this account, and I'm thinking here, Reading and Rebellion, ending in 1960, does this genre of didactic writing from the left die off as we get to the end of the turbulent 20th century? Does it linger on, or does it change?
It changes, and it becomes more inventive, more creative. I think, if I may take you back to my own country, to the US, one of the places where you see that the change really very obviously is during the McCarthy era, and what a lot of the writers who had been writing for Hollywood or writing in major newspapers couldn't write anymore because they were on the blacklist. So they started writing for children, and you'll find that a lot of the reading schemes and some of the best children's stories of the 1960s are written by people with a very left-wing progressive ideology.
Displaced from the Dream Factory.
That's right, and there is a very interesting book about that material that makes a real parallel between the rise of the civil rights movement, for instance, and all the anti-war demonstrations in the late 60s and 70s in the U.S., and the writing that was done for children by people who have been discredited by McCarthy. And I think you can make a similar case here, though it hasn't been done, and we stopped at 1960, so I haven't done that.
Yes, and there's an interesting thing that's gone on in children's books, both America and here, is to investigate history and look at it in ways that traditionally history books didn't. I mean, just as one example, a book has just come out in America about the boys, mostly boys, not entirely, who resisted the Hitler Youth. These were called the Edelweisspiraten, a little picture book for very young children about resisting totalitarianism. Now, that radical tradition now runs through children's books in a variety of ways, in ways that in the 40s, 50s, you couldn't very easily get books published like that. You could a bit, but not very much.
If you think about what was happening in the 1960s, you had things like the Children's Rights Workshop producing write-on feminist children's books and feminist fairy tales and things that were trying to recognize different ethnicities. You had Lila Berg with her Nippers series. You had John Rowe Townsend, who was a Guardian journalist, writing about working-class kids growing up and trying to show their own environment. So you begin to find that there's different kinds of fiction, from picture books and early readers right through to young adult novels that are beginning to deal with these issues in different, more engaged, and I would say probably better written ways. But they're feeding off this earlier tradition, I think, still.
Kimberly Reynolds and Michael Rosen. Reading and Rebellion, an anthology of radical writing for children, is out now. And Workers' Tales, Socialist Fairy Tales, Fables and Allegories is published in November. You're listening to Free Thinking with me, Anne McElvoy, and if this is hitting the magical spot, you can find plenty more to enjoy in our Arts and Ideas podcasts. LSD, Witches, and What We Can Learn from St. Augustine. That's just a taste of some of our recent editions. Go on, have a forage and treat yourself.
I'm Hans Christian Andersen, I've many a tale to tell. And though I'm a cobbler, I'd say I tell them rather well. I'll mend your shoes and I'll fix your boots when I have a moment free. When I'm not otherwise occupied as a bookmobile back or a mountainside or a quarter after three. I'm Hans Christian Andersen, Andersen, that's me.
Danny Kaye in the 1952 film Hans Christian Andersen. But there's a very different version of the great Danish writer currently appearing at the Bridge Theatre in London in Martin McDonagh's new play A Very, Very, Very Dark Matter, starring Jim Broadbent and Phil Daniels. Young adult writer Catherine Webber, who also writes as Katie Tsang, has been to see the play. Catherine, this is not Hans Christian Andersen as portrayed by cheery Danny Kaye there. or not indeed as we would think of him from other sources.
No, not at all. It was not at all what I was expecting. That said, I think that Jim Broadbent did an incredible job bringing a new kind of Hans Christian Andersen to life. He was definitely portrayed almost more of a buffoon and a charlatan, which was a very interesting take.
It's an interesting take, but does it really have anything much at all to do with Hans Christian Andersen? He's foul-mouthed in the play, he's nationalistic, he's oppressive, he's basically the dead white male in the worst form of radical academics imagination.
He really was. I was thinking when I was watching it, it made me think it felt like a bit like they were trying to do with colonialism what Inglourious Basterds had done with Nazis. We're going to address this and make it extremely provocative and have lots of foul language and really ramp it up. And so it was definitely very politically incorrect. And I do agree it was an interesting choice. But I think for what the writer was trying to do, maybe it worked. I was intrigued by it because I grew up loving Hans Christian Andersen. My husband is originally from Hong Kong, but he was born in Denmark, in Copenhagen, so he actually came along to watch the play, and there was quite a few jokes about Chinese and Danes, and he was like, this was made to directly offend me. Interesting. I have a lot of familiarity with Hans Christian Andersen.
How much of the sending up of Hans Christian Andersen do you think makes sense, even if we allow...